Francesca T. Royster is a professor of English at DePaul University, where she teaches courses in Shakespeare studies, performance studies, critical race theory, gender and queer theory, and African American literature. She received her PhD in English from the University of California, Berkeley in 1995. She is the author of Becoming Cleopatra, The Shifting Image of an Icon, and Sounding Like a No-No, Queer Sounds and Outrageous Acts in the Post-Soul Era, which won honorable mention in the Modern Language Association's William Sanders Scarborough Prize for Outstanding Scholarly Study of African American Literature and Culture. She has also published numerous books and scholarly essays in Biography, Journal of Popular Music Studies, Shakespeare Quarterly, Shakespeare Studies, Text and Performance Studies. She is at work on a new book project, and it looks at Blackness in country music. She has trained and volunteered as a counselor for the Chicago Rape Crisis Hotline and has served on nonprofit boards such as Women and Girls Can and Beyond Media Education. Her other interests include activism through performance and other forms of art and learning to play jazz on the upright bass. So thank you so much, Professor Royster, for joining us today. If y'all like podcasts, we are getting a live podcast reading from her very own book. So without further ado, Adarius, you can stop sharing your screen, and Professor Royster, we will let you take it away.
Thank you so much for that great introduction, Ruthie. I forgot all about our work on Little Kim. That was just like a life-changing chance to work with Miriam and with you and with those girls from Rogers Park. It was really an amazing time. So I really appreciate the invitation to come and share a little bit of my work on Cleopatra and popular culture. Thanks so much to Ruthie, to April, Adarius, Harolyn, the Black Alumni Chapter Committee. It's really an honor. And thank you all for coming and spending a little time with us today. So I'm going to read a little bit from Becoming Cleopatra. It was a book that was from my dissertation, which I wrote on Shakespeare and race. It's called Shakespeare's Racial Others. And I was really looking at the 16th century as this time of formation in terms of our ideas about race and kind of the inheritance of it. And by the time I finished, I realized that I didn't really want to write about Shakespeare anymore. I really wanted to write about Black popular culture. So this book was really important to me because it was one of the chapters from the dissertation. And then I decided just to expand it and make it what I wanted. And I was really interested in thinking about how for Black people are negotiation of self through popular images, how important that is. And I was looking at film and really thinking about music and thinking about literature as well. And, you know, I've found myself really interested in representations and images, like what Patricia Hill Collins has written about in terms of controlling images and stereotypes of Black people. But I've become even more interested in those moments of resistance and how we can work within the popular eye as well as outside of it to challenge and create new futures. So that's kind of where my work has gone, especially from my dissertation on to the books that I've been working on and writing and the classes that I've taught at DePaul. And I've loved teaching as just a laboratory for just trying to think about those things and think about what, you know, what is the parts of popular culture that mean a lot to all of us and to students and to me, and writing about that. So, okay, I'm gonna read a little bit, show a few clips, and then we'll have a conversation. And I'm gonna start by just reading the beginning of the book so that you kind of have an idea of what the thesis is. Okay. The Cleopatra icon has remained powerful over time because she signifies reinvention, the fantasy of being able to slough off one's tires and mantles for a new skin. If there is one passage that would best describe the Cleopatra icon, It would be Enobarbus's description of Cleopatra emerging from her barge, from Shakespeare's Antony and Cleopatra. Age cannot wither her, nor custom stale her infinite variety. Other women cloy the appetites they feed, but she makes hungry where most she satisfies. Cleopatra inspires in those who love her the desire to know her. An image always still in formation, Cleopatra slides out of the poet's and the scholar's grasp. It is not for nothing that Shakespeare's most memorable description of Cleopatra is put in the mouth of one of his most articulate cynics of love and politics. What Enobarbus sees and what Antony does not is that Cleopatra makes hungry where most she satisfies. That is, she can never be satisfactorily described or explained because she's always shifting. To attempt a history of the Cleopatra icon is to always leave something out. I found myself writing an anti-genealogy of the Cleopatra icon rather than a history of her. Unlike the linear shape of history, this anti-genealogy favors variation, offshoots, and the contradictions in culture that the Cleopatra icon raises. What began as a search for the roots of Cleopatra's multiple identities has evolved into a mapping of some of her routes, some well-traveled and others less so. So this section is from, this next section is called, Was Cleopatra Black? Reinventing History and the Politics of Appropriation. In John Singleton's casting of Iman as the Egyptian queen in his 1990 video for Michael Jackson's song, Remember the Time, he implicitly links the notoriety of Cleopatra with that of the supermodel to further a narrative that is about, among other things, identity under the conditions of extreme fame. This theme is furthered by Singleton's use of other extremely recognizable faces in the video, including Eddie Murphy as the Egyptian king and, of course, the king of pop himself. The video taps into the Afrocentric notion of Egypt as a lost and glorious past, but one that is also in danger of losing its relevance to the masses. It revolves around a story of a king and queen who have everything but have lost a sense of enchantment in their relationship. Both Murphy and Iman are portrayed as beautiful but also tyrannical, their personal frustrations translating into a lack of care about their subjects. In that way, the video seems to echo narratives about the decadent lifestyles of the historical Antony and Cleopatra. Iman's image represents a fantasy version of Africa that is distant, glamorous, but also removed from the context of everyday history. Her rise from model to American supermodel celebrity has been influenced in part by her distinction as an African rather than African-American model. Yet the specificity of her personal biography, that she hails from Somalia in particular, a place that has made its mark on mainstream consciousness because of its association with famine, violence, and extreme geographical conditions, has been played down in her publicity. But it is Michael Jackson's role in the video that Cleopatra's in the transcendent sense that I will use in this book. From the little boy who sang love songs like an adult to the adult who hangs out with children and animals on Neverland Ranch, from his rumored associations with mummification, including his taste for sleeping in oxygen chambers and his collection of the bones of the original elephant man, to his compulsive experiments with his own face through plastic surgery, makeup, and acid washes for the skin, Jackson, shape changer, style maker, thriller, is the ultimate figure of becoming. In the video that we're gonna watch a little bit of, Jackson plays a jester who travels through time to ancient Egypt to entertain the king and queen and to help them recapture their romance. Jackson's sexual and racial ambiguity plays against both the Black nationalist ideals of Black king and Black queen and the sexual extremes of Murphy as one hyper-masculine ideal and Iman as gloriously graceful but high maintenance femme. Actually, I would say gender, not sexual this time. Jackson distracts us from Iman and Murphy. We are encouraged to remember the time of the pharaohs and queens, but we are also captivated by Jackson's mutable, wandering, nonlinear impersonation of memory. Memory, here the sometimes controversial cultural memory of African American links to ancient Egypt, shifts before our eyes in the same way that Jackson slips in and out of the narrative, dancing, spinning, turning, first into a cat and then into sand, teasingly alluding racial and gender categorization. And I'm going to just share a quick clip.
That's cold. And what is it you're going to do?
Verbo, no. Sorry. Back to Okay, so I could keep listening to Michael Jackson throughout the song, but I do want to get to some of the other examples. So I was really interested in that moment because to me, it really showed this image of this idea of belonging. And in a lot of the popular appropriations of Cleopatra, I really see this desire to connect to the past, but also to make something new out of it. So throughout the book, I look at different examples, including I look at not just African-American appropriations of Cleopatra in popular culture, but Theda Bara, who is a Jewish silent film actress, who then kind of creates this new self through the figure of Cleopatra. I look at Elizabeth Taylor and kind of the white grotesque, like this larger than life kind of decadent over-the-top image that she uses through her film. And then I look at Leslie Uggams, who played Cleopatra as well. You might know her, remember her from the first Roots. And the last two chapters are on Cleopatra Jones, which is a 1973 Blaxploitation film, and Set It Off by John Singleton from 1996, I believe, and Queen Latifah's performance of Cleo. So I'm gonna just touch down really fast on those last two examples, just to give you a taste of what I'm doing. So in Becoming Cleopatra, Cleopatra Jones in the Blaxploitation film, I was really interested in kind of the naming of her as Cleopatra, which I think is not accidental because she's the secret agent. She's like really glamorous and beautiful and always moving and changing. But she also is part of a storyline that's about fending off the surveillance of the police and kind of needing someone who is really knowledgeable about images and changing the kind of able to kind of change and escape through their image, which I think is a running theme with all of the Cleopatras that I look at, this ability to reinvent yourself. So I also talk a little bit about the fact that in terms of Shakespeare, at this moment, it was very rare to cast Black actors as Cleopatra, that usually she was performed as not brown, not Black, but white. And then they would use Black actors in the background to kind of give local color and spectacle, but not ever cast an actor of color in the role of Cleopatra. So I thought, given that, the fact that Black culture has made use of Cleopatra for themselves is just kind of interesting and telling. So I'll read a little bit from the section on Cleopatra Jones. So what is it that makes Cleopatra Jones a revision of Shakespeare exactly? The film's Cleopatra shares with Shakespeare's Cleopatra the capacity to serve as an agent, the ability to stimulate the desires of competing camps and to instigate change through these desires. Tamara Dobson's Cleopatra is a lost African queen dripping in furs and silk robes. She's a hybrid of an exotic queen from the past, a homegirl who knows her way around her old neighborhood of Watts, LA, and a special agent for the CIA. In the film, we see a double act of appropriation made possible by the ambiguity of the Cleopatra icon. The film uses Cleopatra to advance an ideal of the authentic Black woman based on the rhetoric of contemporary Black cultural nationalism. At the same time, it represents Cleopatra Jones as universally desirable. She is a heroine for all time, and all men and women want her. This desire ultimately unifies the vying powers of Los Angeles in the film. If in Shakespeare's play, Cleopatra distracts Anthony from his political responsibilities to Rome, in the film, CIA agent Jones protects Los Angeles from the brink of riot. And I'm just going to show the trailer, original trailer for the film. It's really a fun film. There's also a sequel. Excuse me. Okay, let us take a look at that trailer. Okay.
So much as a cough drop. I'm coming down on you so hard.
Tamara Dobson, the Soul Sisters' answer to James Bond, and the most exciting new star in years. 6'2" of dynamite, and it's all stacked.
I told you where, and I told you when, and I told you how to get there. Cleopatra Jones. She is sticking her nose in my business, Zach!
And up against her is the archenemy, the female successor to Goldfinger, two-time Academy Award winner Shelley Winters as Mommy.
Before I make you eat it.
Well, I don't want this town to blow up.
Big deal. Just hang it right there.
Ah!
is 10 miles of bad road.
Take care of Cleopatra, Joe.
Cleopatra Jones, starring Tamara Dobson, co-starring Bernie Casey, Brenda Sykes, Esther Rowe, and Shelley Winters as Mommy.
So Cleopatra Jones, I definitely recommend. It's got a little bit of everything. It's got humor. It's got great kung fu action. And it's really historically relevant because it is very much grounded in recognizing kind of different political uprisings happening in LA in response to the LA Police Department in Watts and elsewhere, and really comes out of that, I think, in kind of interesting ways. So I grew up watching blaxploitation movies and kind of being taken to them, even though I was kind of too young to go, watching them in drive-ins. And I remember this one and just like being really fascinated and excited, because a lot of them don't have female protagonists. Mostly women are kind of in the background. Okay, so the last film that I talk about is Set It Off, which is John Singleton's film, with also Jada Pinkett and all kinds of other, Vivica Fox and great, some of my favorite people. And really also thinking about LA this time, Compton. And I focus in on the character of Cleo, who's played by Queen Latifah. And in general, in my analysis of the film, I kind of think about triple consciousness, like the way that Black people in the film and in Black women in general are aware of their image and kind of manipulating that image to resist sometimes, and sometimes just to survive. So that is what I saw underlying the film. So a little bit from the book on it, and then we'll watch a clip really fast. Okay. To what extent must Black women strategize to control the gaze? Cleopatra is a useful sign for discussing the control of the gaze because of her much rumored allure and control over men through the performance of her desirability and her capture and display by her enemies as a means of power. In Shakespeare's version of her legend, Octavius Caesar delights that he will take the captured Cleopatra and parade her through the marketplace. Cleopatra struggles to interrupt this particular display by committing suicide, which she stages in a most provocative way, the most provocative way that she knows how. In Queen Latifah's role as Cleo in the film Set It Off from 1996, we see a critique of the criminalization of Black women in the media via a newly queered version of the femme fatale. And I'm gonna skip a bit. Okay, so Set It Off, if you haven't watched it recently, or if you haven't watched it at all, is again about this group of childhood friends who decide to take up bank robbing in order to create possibilities in their lives that have been shut down otherwise. And and everybody in the film seems to kind of enjoy what they're doing. They kind of enjoy the performance of being a criminal and of bank robbing in particular. But there's also kind of this sense of ethical pull, especially that Jada Pinkett kind of struggles with. So, but I'm really interested in the fact, in the decision that John Singleton made to make one of the women explicitly a butch lesbian and to name her Cleo. And yeah, it just got my attention. I'm also queer. So I started thinking about it and I've got a little obsessed with it. Okay, so just a little more reading. Set It Off works to expose the ways that the relations among Black womanhood, poverty, and criminality are naturalized by the camera. The film encourages us to think about the ways that film circulates and even promotes such images. For example, images of the women are captured and scrutinized using a variety of surveillance methods in the film. We watch others watching security videos from hidden cameras at the bank, mugshots, and fingerprints held in police files. In one scene, the investigating officer takes surveillance photos of Cleo, Frankie, and Stoney. The results, moody close-ups in glossy black and white, look as much like the headshots used by a casting agent as security photos. At the same time, this critique is complicated by the power and pleasure implicit in being made the criminal spectacle and performing a role, however limited or familiar, and doing it well. The film represents the robberies themselves as theater. Each robbery is carefully blocked and choreographed by the women. They assemble costumes, and in 1970s wigs and sunglasses, the women look more like they belong in the Ike and Tina Turner review than in a gang. And significantly, Kate Lanier, one of the film's screenwriters, was also the writer for the 1993 film, What's Love Got to Do with It?, a biopic about Ike and Tina Turner's early career and turbulent marriage. Ramsey Lewis's snazzy old school jazz hit The In Crowd plays in the background while words of reassurance repeated like chants to the bank audience, watch it, come on, keep it moving, move the action along. The element of self-reflexivity about performance is furthered by the casting of Queen Latifah as Cleo and fellow rapper Dr. Dre as Black Sam, the leader of the neighborhood gang. Moreover, Set It Off self-consciously telegraphs its film IQ and its place in the gangster film genre by including an extended riff on The Godfather, as well as visual allusions to Thelma and Louise, Public Enemy Number One, Bonnie and Clyde, Butch Cassidy and the Sundance Kid, and the television coverage of the O.J. Simpson Bronco police chase. As the film advances, we see more examples of the women being watched by others in their role as gangster. As their performances as criminals become more polished, the women become increasingly successful in holding the gaze. We watch as the police department's investigators watch and rewatch the film of their first robbery, carefully freezing the film on the women's faces. While in their normal lives, these women were virtually invisible to most of the society, here the investigators, most of whom are white males, give the film of the women an obsessive, almost loving level of attention. Cleo most self-consciously relishes this attention. It is Cleo who most clearly registers pleasure at the role of gangster. One critic has called her a big, noisy, outrageous bundle of walking female id. Cleo has the hand signals, the stare and tough stance of the gangster, breaking into cars in 20 seconds, shooting two guns at once. Cleo even has a mall, the beautiful Ursula, who listens in on the plotting, silently waits for her instructions, and silently watches her lover's capture by the police. Cleo eventually stands out as the woman most able to improvise and build on the role. In their last robbery, Cleo spectacularly drives through the plate glass window of a bank in a Ford Bronco, upsetting a carefully arranged pyramid of bears, which have become, by this point in the film, her trademark. Set It Off complicates the portrait of Black women as merely objectified, as completely under the power of the gaze, by detailing the lure and function of underground tactics of power like crime. In this way, the film makes more explicit the issues of surveillance and technology underlying Cleopatra Jones. These women rob banks not only to sustain themselves economically, to survive, but also to control the gaze. But to what extent is Set It Off also implicated as a film that hawks the pleasure of looking? This question becomes particularly pointed when we consider Cleo's death. And I will, for my last clip, I'll show the death of Queen Latifah's character, Cleo. Okay. hopefully everybody's still with me in terms of the technology. Sorry, I always get so into that scene that I forget that the clip is actually over. It always takes me in. So Queen Latifah's Cleo occupies a role that we've seen so many times before, played by men, black and white. And it's important that we see her whole body in this final shot. As we watch her, we know that we have seen this all before, but we're also made aware of the difference of her body from all the other movie bodies we've seen. She manages to be both large and vulnerable. Her body is different from the supermodel bodies of Pinkett and Fox. She's not wearing makeup. Her hair is in everyday cornrows. At the moment of death, she manages to be both heroic and vulnerable, mythic and a homely girl. Although this scene is lit darkly with blue filter, in these last moments of her life, we see the gleam of the sweat of her panic, the fading light in her eyes. As we watch her play this role to the hilt, we are aware that we have never really seen this before. Cleo satisfies a desire that we never knew we had. And that's it. Happy to answer questions, talk about the book, the writing of it, or anything else. Thanks.
Thank you, Professor Royster. We do have a few questions. I think one of the first questions, there's a lot of, a lot of uncertainty about Cleopatra's background. And so just, I guess a basic question would be, is Cleopatra really Black, or is she more of, a mixture, several different cultures and ethnicities?
Yeah, that's a great question. And that's one that I really played a lot with in the book and just in researching this. So the historic Cleopatra records are that she was Greek, and assumably white, although the category of white, wasn't really with us exactly, but that she, as a queen, a Greek queen who kind of controlled basically like Egypt as a colony of Greece, she learned the culture of the people, and the people of Egypt were multi-hued and multi-raced, and kind of learned how to be an insider in that culture. So that's what I know, although I think that people are always revisiting that question and thinking about, for example, the historic Cleopatra's mother is kind of shadowy in terms of who she was, and some people speculate that she was a Nubian servant. So there's a lot of room for speculation, but in terms of the sources that I was using for the book, you know, I kind of accepted that idea that she was someone who was immersed in many cultures, potentially could be considered multiracial, but also could kind of claim this European heritage at the same time. So on top of that layer of thinking about whether Cleopatra was Black is Shakespeare, which was kind of my starting point, because that was kind of where I was looking. And Shakespeare definitely thought of her as Black. So that, so he was part of a tradition in literature and in art of, hold on. I think this is my YouTube. Just a minute, let me make sure I have everything off. Sorry, somewhere set it off was continuing to go in the background of my screen. So anyway, so Shakespeare imagined her as Black. And describes her skin as Black and sunburned and ebony and all these different images. And so there are these competing ways of representing her as Black and as non-Black. And sometimes it's like where the money is, usually where the most power is, she's represented as white, at least in our own contemporary culture. But, you know, in the 90s, when I was writing my dissertation, you know, there was kind of a resurgence of interest in her as a figure of Blackness historically, as well as kind of culturally, but I'm more making the claim of how people have imagined her, not so much about the history.
Thank you. We also have another observation, I guess. Kanisha says, I noticed that in order to be a fierce take, no prisoners queen, they had to harden the women in the Black stories. But in white depictions, she's a womanly, succulent temptress, i.e. Elizabeth Taylor.
Yeah, that's right, Kanisha. And hi, Kanisha. Yeah, is this Kanisha Yates? Anyway, Kanisha, hi. Yeah, I think that is so interesting that these images really do of Black women are like tough, distanced fighters, and that she's in the images by Theda Bara and by Elizabeth Taylor. Yeah, she's like kind of much more an object to be looked at, kind of more soft and more vulnerable, but also kind of in control of the show in a different kind of way, like in a much more sexualized, in some ways in a more sexualized way. But I think that says a lot about kind of the myth of the strong Black woman and just the reality of struggle too, that that comes through. And I think Set It Off is a really good example of that as well, where strength and hardness or fierceness is something that is valued in the film, but also, you know, is something that the women themselves are struggling with because they want a more multidimensional way of living in the world. So thanks for bringing that up.
I'm curious, Professor Royster, did you, in researching of your various images of Cleopatra throughout history, popular images, did you come across a lot of stereotypes? When I think of Cleopatra, I really do think of like exotic and sexual, and you know, did you find a lot of heavy usage of like these stereotypes when you were doing your research on popular images of Cleopatra?
Yeah, definitely. I think that I do think that there are a lot of stereotypes, and really the way that I ended up kind of thinking about her image, or the icon of her image, is that it was partly kind of reflecting what it feels like to be made into a stereotype. Like it was like a stereotype or an image about that feeling and trying to use it strategically or escape it otherwise. And that was kind of how, especially in 20th century examples, I kept sort of seeing her as this very self-conscious, historically conscious figure. But yeah, there's some just really disturbing and ugly images of her as well. And really kind of thinking about how race comes in for that. But there's also ways that she becomes a code word for beauty, for like, there are all these different makeup lines that are named after her, and perfumes. And I know in Toni Morrison's novel Jazz, the main character sells a line of powder and beauty, I think makeup, that's called Cleopatra Beauty Products. So I actually have a bottle of perfume on my shelf that's named after her too. But yeah, and I think that part of the stereotype, along with kind of being the exotic, being insatiable, and being sexual, is also this idea of being corrupt. And that's something that like Western culture has also kind of imported into her history of kind of the real person, this idea that she was kind of a political sellout, that she was a strategist who had no morals. And often the ways that she's stereotyped as sexually insatiable also is connected to political power. And, you know, might have to do with the role of Rome and kind of the Roman Empire as it was trying to acquire and compete with Egypt. So yeah, there's a lot of nastiness going on in the history for sure.
And we just have like another kind of an observation from Artina. I think the book is based upon pop culture, is based upon poetry or descriptions of various Cleopatra icons, similar to Set It Off, meaning what image could be classified as Cleopatra throughout entertainment history?
Okay, so maybe I need to hear the question again, but like kind of thinking about other Cleopatras besides film, like thinking of other forms of entertainment. Because I can definitely think of like, there's a great musical group from the 1990s called Cleopatra, young Afro-British women. What is the book about? Okay, yeah. Yeah, so the book is, it's focusing especially on film and kind of taking the visual idea of Cleopatra as an idea about being controlled by the gaze or by other people's views, and kind of trying to reinvent yourself to control where your story goes. And that's something that at the foundation of the book is, Cleopatra, Shakespeare's imagining of her, which kind of, to me, kind of foregrounded that idea of struggling with your image and trying to reinvent or escape it. But in all of the images that I look at in the book, there's also definitely this idea of the exotic and what it feels to be an exotic or exoticized, and different ways of sometimes capitalizing it, sometimes resisting or creating something else or something new. So I hope that that answers your question.
On a personal note, Professor Royster, you've probably heard about there's going to be the new version of Cleopatra with Gal Gadot producing and starring in it. Who would you like to see today if there was a movie coming out, you know, of Cleopatra? What stars would you like to see, or actresses do you think would really be a good image or fulfill what you would like to see Cleopatra portrayed as?
Well, it might not be the most radical choice, but the person who comes to mind immediately is Beyoncé. Maybe because I've been writing about her for my book that I'm working on right now and looking at Lemonade. But the way that her, definitely her glamour, but also the layers that she's able to convey through music and just through her kind of stage presence, her interest in kind of revisiting Black women in history and Lemonade. I think that she could bring something really interesting, especially if the movie was in the right hands. But it would also be interesting to play with skin tone and not go with the lighter skinned or racially ambiguous figure, but maybe think of someone darker, and to think about that as a powerful image to rethink beauty. But I've been waiting for that film for a long time, and I hope it definitely comes to be soon.
Okay, I think there's one last question that I missed. It was from Ruthie. I'm really curious about the intersection of Cleo within your work. Love modern analysis. I guess, I think you did address this, but why did you choose to include the character of Cleo, and what impact, I guess, or influence do you feel that Queen Latifah's portrayal had?
Thank you for that, Ruthie. I did it partly because I'm a big fan of Queen Latifah's, and I really wanted at least one example to show a wider spectrum of female sexuality. And so I was interested in that, and I also really admire John Singleton as a filmmaker. I think that he really just opened up stories about Black life. So Set It Off was great for that. But I really also, I just loved Queen Latifah's playfulness and her boldness in this performance. And to me, it felt like it just added a different layer to the history of this icon, to these representations that I hadn't seen before. So I think that I kind of have been of the opinion that Queen Latifah can do anything that she wants. Like, she's a singer, she's a performer, she's a talk show host, and maybe her potential was even more clear at that moment in the late 90s, but I think she's still reinventing herself too. And I just like the range. I appreciate the range of the things that she's been able to do. So I wanted to raise that up as well in terms of thinking of her as a performer.
Thank you, Professor.
You're welcome. This has been really fun. It's been great to think about this project again. For so many years, when I was writing my diss. And then afterwards, when I first became a professor, this was like my obsession. So, you know, even as I've moved on and thought about other projects and written other books, like this is still where my heart is. So it's really fun to talk about it again and to hear what you think about it. So thank you for inviting me.